The second part of the plan could begin. The pilots were eager to deliver their presents, as they called them,
to what they called the Children of Hamburg.
There was just one problem. The target could not be seen in the dark. Flares would betray the surprise attack. We've got to get the subs before they dive. Therefore, I had to mark the target from the ground. The tanker standing near the quay would provide more than enough light.
That won't be more suspicious than a flare.
An explosive charge would be enough to turn night into day. There had to be explosives somewhere in this naval harbor. I only had to find them.
I'm noticing a trend with your general preparedness, Violette. We are past the docks and onto the harbor storage area now, where we're likely to see all sorts of nifty things. Oddly enough, none of them has to do with harbors, water, or submarines. However, we do get to play with this flare gun. Violet, did you just cram a Nazi in the locker? Jiggling Nazis aside, we have work to do. These explosives aren't going to find themselves. There's a lever inside this next cage section, and I think we all know what that means. Replicating the Galvani experiment for fun and profit. As you'll recall, I promised to light a Nazi on fire at some point, and that point is now. I'm entirely certain that isn't how a flare gun works, but I can't be so sure that these Nazis aren't wearing uniforms made from gun cotton. Most German uniforms were made from wool, but we certainly aren't dealing with the most competent members of the Wehrmacht here.
Somehow I had to find a way past the guards to reach the train. Not a simple task.
Well, it's somewhat simple, really just the same stabbing motion a few dozen times.
Very cramped in here. I had to be careful I didn't run straight into the arms of the guards. They could have been standing around any corner.
They're not really standing anywhere. This room is full to the brim with patrollers, and that doesn't really look safe at all. Who sits their giant spool of wire on its side like that? As soon as this soldier joins us in the shadows, I'll put him in the pile with the other. You can see a collectible twinkling beneath that set of crates, but we can't access it yet, so I'll just smash this fuse box instead. A guard with a flashlight springs into action and shows tremendous initiative by looking where everything didn't happen. When he starts to relax, I can leapfrog to the next alcove. There's my chance. This can sometimes spook the final guard, so I'll back up, but we seem to be in the clear. I'll circle around the outside to get at him. Someone had mentioned wanting to see what happened when I messed up, and I thought I had the perfect example in this room, where killing the first guard somehow alerted the entire area, but Fraps was giving me some issues and it didn't record. Hopefully somewhere down the line I'll have another instance of this happening. Whistling at the top of this ramp brings the last guard running, and I can flank him by using these stairs. The next guard is a cinch, so long as you haven't alerted any of the others. He stands inside this small room with his back to the door. I'll go ahead and switch back to my Colt. I won't need it anytime soon, but it will be useful for the finale. I think this section is designed to confuse you into running straight at this guard, as he doesn't patrol. But a few quick fence hops will put us in the perfect position to confuse him right back. For the sake of expediency, I'm going to use some morphine here. Now, I know I said I wasn't going to be backtracking to grab any collectibles, but I've kind of changed my mind. Since it's going to take a few minutes or so to lift the crates below and grab the next one, why don't I explain what this badge is? The Edelweiss is a mountain flower that generally grows only in high altitudes and difficult-to-reach locations. As a result, Emperor Franz Joseph I of Austria-Hungary used an image of the flower as the symbol for his Alpine troops. This practice has continued in Germany up to the present. So, in fact, it makes it about as much sense as finding a sniper badge in a closet. Meanwhile, below, the collectible we saw earlier is accessible, and it turns out to be a Marine Honor Dagger. This is one of three unique daggers we can find throughout the game, each worth a pretty penny of experience. You'll recall that we found the Army Honor Dagger in the Hedge Alcove back at the Cathedral. That's all the backtracking we'll need to do, so it's time to get back to work. After all, this game isn't about daggers. It's about knives.
I realize and I can see that suicide is painless. It brings on many changes, and I can take or leave it if I please.
After that little hallucination, I think it's high time to pick up some more morphine. We'll pass through what appears to be a janitor's closet and take advantage of close quarters to dispatch an additional two Nazis. And after they're both down, we're free to mash another lever. You can see the stack of crates being lifted below.
I had to get down there somehow. Maybe there were stairs farther to the back.
Most buildings that are over two stories have stairs, Violet. This guard will stop just before coming within alert range, which lets us set up to take him out as soon as he turns. This locker has another flare gun inside, so we're gonna skip it. As fun as it is to light Nazis on fire, it's actually surprisingly difficult to hit them with a flare gun, and we'll be getting something much better soon. In the same sense, that door leads into a room that contains a flak vest and a medkit, neither of which I really need. If I'm doing things correctly, I shouldn't be getting shot in the first place. This seems like a very odd way of storing equipment. They've entirely blocked off this electrical panel. It works out for us, as this conduit is running directly into a puddle beneath the stack of crates we just lifted. With that completed, it's time to dispatch a few more Nazis. Huh. How did they even get that spool there? Did they roll it into place? Passing by more Bremen-bound cargo, this guard is easy enough. And then it's back the way we came to circle up and around for the next. You can see another Nazi in the background, but don't worry, that's just a ghost. Still, I have no plans to alert any ghosts, so I'll take a roundabout route to reach my final destination. There's our explosives, looking precisely the same as they did back in France. These missions would be far less successful if the Nazis didn't personally provide me with the means to sabotage them. This locker contains a shotgun, which is a good indication of what lay ahead. Anytime they give you a scatter gun, you can expect a situation where they don't intend for you to use stealth. Unlike Old Willy's Crypt, we will end up having to use it this time through. As soon as we pass through back out into the warehouse proper, the ghost from before makes some noise that alerts the guard, giving us the chance to catch him. For our Nazi ghost, he's very helpful. Searching the body, we'll find a key to unlock the exit, and around the corner is another Hanseatic cross.
Da hast du aber Glück gehabt. Einem Freund von mir hat eine Granate die Beine weggerissen. Den Anblick kann ich nicht mehr vergessen.
Hast du noch Kippen?
Nee. Kein Stück.
Schade.
Tja. Naja, beim Ivan rauchen sie auch getrocknete Kuhfladen, wenn sie keinen Tabak haben.
Na, die saufen doch bestimmt auch den Sprit aus ihren Panzern. Na, zdrowie!
Wär möglich. Naja, ich werd mal weiter.
Ja, was zum...
Das war Donia, Comrades.
I I could already hear the bombers. I had to hurry.
We're gonna use height to our advantage out here, and I'll start off by whistling the closest guard over while I attend to some business. Someone's nightcap becomes our experience, and by now the guard I whistled over should be in position for a second whistling. The height difference here makes it more difficult for him to see us, and as soon as he turns around, I can jump down and kill him. We'll go ahead and stash his body in the corner here, and head forward to get the officer's attention. He should head straight for the sound of the whistle, which will let us loop around that first set of crates to come out behind him. Officers tend to stay alerted for a longer period of time than the average soldier. This can be annoying if you're waiting for them to stop facing you, but when you need them to stay in place, it's a godsend. For a second there, I thought Violette bashed him so hard that his arm spontaneously fell off. With those two gone, this next soldier's no problem. As soon as he meanders by this cargo mountain, I'll chase him down and cram him back somewhere for safekeeping. Looks like I was wrong. There is a second shed in this level. And now that that's dealt with, let's see what the shed has to offer. A lever that will cut the power to that puddle over there, and a box of shotgun shells that may actually come in handy. There's no one around to hear me jogging, so we'll make a run for the fence and then leap into a hidden alcove behind it. Inside, there are more shells, some morphine, and a music box. You may be tempted to light up these barrels to see if they expose some hidden objective, but trust me, they don't. Seems our murder spree has gained some attention while we were inside, as these two have shown up to investigate. They can't see back here, so we're free to hop the fence and get into position. Despite this guard being closer, we're going to want to hit the other first, as his patrol stops much earlier. Once he's down, we're free to gingerly step around the grenade that has been driven into the ground here and dispatch his friend. That's the last of them for now, but we're going to want to put ourselves in a good position immediately, and once we pass between these two train cars, another three soldiers will spawn at the general area of that shed. They start off alerted, but I think we can get a few silent kills before opening fire. With that spray of buckshot, we are stepping into the finale for this mission.
Hooray! I needed to reach my getaway car on the other side of the wall before all hell broke loose.
Hooray indeed! We're gonna want to sprint to the end of this train to get away from the resulting firestorm. Although it would seem that the Nazis have a similar idea, and there's no time to aim for silent kills in this following section. This will be our last refuge, and there's another flak jacket, a med kit, some shotgun shells, and a harmonica, all of which should be useful in our flight to safety. another sequence that's designed for open combat, which is really a shame because Velvet Assassin does not handle gunplay all that well. It takes 3 shots from the Colt to kill a Nazi on regular difficulty unless you hit them directly in the head. Also, Violet can take very little damage, even with the flak jacket, so reloading while enemies are still active is a death sentence. Therefore, we'll only switch to the shotgun after taking down these two, because we don't want to end up running out of ammunition in the next stretch. That's usually the last of them, but the game will occasionally spawn additional soldiers at the getaway car. If we're lucky, we can sprint to the end before it does so. We just have to make sure to grab this pilot's watch from under these flaming barrels.
The submarines were destroyed that night. Operation Gamora was a complete success.
When did she change?
Later, I heard that 30,000 civilians were also killed.